We're going live. And what's up, everybody? It's Mover. Welcome to Mondays with Mover live with Lieutenant Colonel Dan Rooney, fighter pilot, author, founder of Folds of Honor, F-16 pilot, T-38 pilot. What else? Got everything, man. He is a man of many talents. So today, we're going to celebrate 200,000 subscribers. We're going to tell his story and do a quick interview. We've got the chat up, so we'll take some questions along the way and more towards the end. But first, how are you, sir? How is the quarantine going?
Mover, I'm awesome. Congratulations on 200,000 subscribers. That is fantastic and well-deserved. You're one of the most interesting guys I've ever met. And so blessed to call you a friend and fly jets with you.
Yes.
You know, defend freedom and live this life together.
But not a lot of jet flying, right? I mean, as you can see, there hasn't been a lot of...
Yeah, that's a, you know, that's kind of a, you know, a cool place to start. And the quarantine's good. You know, I've got five daughters.
Oh, wow.
And so I'm quarantined with six women, which would be most everybody's dream.
I'm in.
No, we're having fun. I'm coming to you from the land of common sense, which is a town called Owosso, Oklahoma.
Okay.
Outside of Tulsa at the Patriot Golf Club. So it's God and country with no apology here. And if you don't like it, you're not invited. So this is not a politically correct place.
No, we don't do that here. We don't do that on this channel. So awesome. Well, yeah. First, I would like to ask, because everybody always wants to know, how did Noonan become a fighter pilot? How did you get into aviation? How did the bug hit you? What got you into this amazing profession?
All right, so you know, stories are what lives in people's hearts and minds. So this is a good story. So, you know, fasten your seatbelt, arm your ejection seat, green it up. So I grew up in Stillwater, Oklahoma. My dad taught at Oklahoma State University. We played a lot of golf together growing up, and I was 12 years old, and I call them moments of synchronicity or chance with a purpose.
Mm-hmm.
And I was playing in this golf tournament, and one of the guys in my group was a guy named Steve Portwright, call sign Reno. And he was an F-4 driver.
Nice.
in the Oklahoma Air Guard, and just an amazing guy. It was my first man crush, right? I mean, this dude looked like he walked. If you looked up fighter pilot in a dictionary, this is him. I mean, just awesome looking dude, you know, old school Ray-Bans on. And I think he let me have a drink of his Coors Light when I was 12. And
nice.
And I'm like, you can be this old and this cool. And he was like, yes, you can. And I'm like, I want to be you when I grow up. And it was a couple weeks later that I was playing golf with my dad, and I'm like, Dad, you know, I know what I want to do with my life. I want to be a golf pro and a fighter pilot.
Yeah, there you go.
And so that was, you know, my inspiration. And obviously I was young at that point, so I got pretty good at golf, which was the first dream. I went to the University of Kansas. So I took a very non-traditional route mm-hmm. to the whole fighter pilot thing. So I went to KU, played golf there, dueled it out with a guy by the name of Tiger Woods.
Nice.
2 years. Yeah, so I played in U.S. amateurs together, NCAA tournaments together. This is just an ad hoc. Tiger told me one of the best jokes ever, and it's a pilot joke.
Okay.
And you know, he's an African-American guy, so I'll trump that. But he came up to me at the PGA Championship, and he said, Noonan, so that's my call sign. I'll explain that in a second. He was like, what do you call a black guy who flies an airplane? And I'm like, I have no idea. And he was, a pilot, you racist.
Nice.
That's Tiger Woods.
Awesome.
So so I go to KU, play golf, and I'd stayed in touch this whole time with Steve Portwright, Reno, mm-hmm. who had gone from, you know, captain in the Oklahoma Air Guard to the wing commander and then the adjutant general of the state of Oklahoma. But he had mentored me all these years. I mean, you gotta have somebody believe in you and mentor you, right?
Absolutely.
If you're gonna get in this
yeah.
business.
Absolutely.
And so a lot of credit to him. And, you know, I got my college degree, had to get that. Graduated from KU with a master's degree.
Wow. What in what? What are your degrees in?
Sports psychology. So I have an undergrad in liberal arts geography and a master's in sports psychology.
Wow.
And then I moved to Florida and turned pro as a golfer. But I had one mission, and it was I knew I wanted to be a fighter pilot. Oh, yeah. But I hadn't made enough money to get my private pilot's license to apply, started applying after I got my private pilot's license, took the AFOQT. I'm geeking out in here.
No, this audience loves it. This is what we're here for. We love this.
And then I started sending my packet off to fighter units in the Air National Guard.
Nice.
And got picked up initially by Portland.
F-15s. Yeah.
Yeah, F-15s. And then I had a subsequent interview here back in Tulsa, which was, you know, close to my hometown. Mm-hmm. And I ended up getting picked up there and went to pilot training and flew Vipers here for 13 years, did 3 combat tours of duty in Iraq. And it was a great run. And obviously I'm flying T-38s with you now, which is the coolest gig in the entire Air Force.
Best job ever.
Looking in the rearview mirror with a bad back and a bad neck.
How is your back, by the way? You're on the mend. How are you feeling better?
I am. And, you know, for the you know, the dirty side of our business, it is the fighter pilot. People that want to go that route, you got to understand, man, it is a full contact. It's like playing in the NFL.
Absolutely.
It really is. And I've been very fortunate my whole career never to have any serious injuries until December 7th of 2019.
A day that will live in infamy.
Yeah, right. Yeah, the other December 7th, right? Not 1941. And so I was checking 6 and pulling about 5 G's looking behind me.
That's a lot in T-38. That's a heaping honk in there.
Because we are in A models, and so we still wear the 50-pound parachute, which is, as I've found out as I've gone down this rabbit hole, that is the worst part of, I think, any fighter out there. And I really do find the T-38 with the parachute on. And so I blew out my L5, and nobody cares the seas which you sail through. They just want to know, do you make it to port? And but I went through 30 days of the absolute most debilitating pain of my entire life. And it's funny because as I went down the road, I discovered all these other people in the T-38 that had blown out disc.
Yeah,
Jeff, who was our old boss. Mm-hmm. Down there, he blew out L4, L5, and Tater, our new boss down there, he blew out his L5 S1.
Jeez.
So it's, you know, it's a dangerous business, and I stay in really good shape, and I'm a healthy guy, but I'm 47. And so I'm hopeful that that I'll make it back, and I'm on a positive trajectory. So that's all I know. I'm playing golf again. Came out of the gate. You like this? Remember my first round back, which was about a month ago, I made a hole in one.
Nice.
So that was another synchronicity that God said, okay,
yes.
Noonan, you're back in the fight, first round back. And
well, by the time we get to go back with the quarantine, maybe it'll be all better. You know, we're talking July, you know, before. So.
And that's a crazy part. You can fill people out on that because people don't realize as a reservist, they won't even let us come fly right now.
If you're outside of 100 miles, it's DOD travel policy. You got to stay at home. But so you mentioned it, so I'll ask, how did you get your call sign?
So I'm the only fighter pilot in the history of the world to be a PGA golf professional and a fighter pilot.
That's awesome.
And my first name is Dan. So the main character, and you can see it, I'm going to spin you over there. See the poster on my wall over there, Caddyshack? The main character in Caddyshack is Danny Noonan. And so hence I'm Noonan. So
awesome.
That's
good.
I've never met another one.
So did you have any moments, you know, we talk about on the channel, Make Them Tell You No, where it's basically somebody's going to tell you you can't do it, or you're going to tell yourself you can't do it. Do you have any moments in your career where, you know, you had to overcome either self-doubt or somebody who knew nothing telling you can't do it to become what you've become today? Have you had any
Yeah, no, I mean, I think every day mover is defined by what you do when it doesn't go your way.
Yep.
So, I mean, it's, you know, every day the world's going to tell you no.
Yep.
And it's, you know, how you react to those moments that will define your legacy.
Well,
and I always use this analogy and I love it. You know, an airplane takes off into the wind for a reason, right? It has to have resistance in order to ascend. And our lives are no different. And so often people, when they run into struggle in this resistance, they think that, you know, God's trying to keep them down. You know, why me? This woe is me defeatist attitude. In reality, those are the moments that lift us up.
Absolutely.
And I think to a person, if there was a quality in the, you know, in the fighter pilot business, you know, it's armadillo skin, because we're one of the few places left in the world where they tell you the truth, not what you want to hear.
Absolutely.
And they don't do it in the feedback sandwich either. Well, you just did this so well.
Coddling. Yeah.
You did this so well.
Yeah.
Excellence is expected and rarely ever recognized.
Yeah.
In any area that falls short, we're going to, you know, debrief to the fullest. So, you know, you get used to that in our business, I think, just by the nature of what it is.
Yeah.
You're going to struggle, but you can look at those struggles as something that ultimately motivate you to get better. And so, heck yeah, brother, you know, all the time, you know, we can talk about folds of honor here in a minute, but that's, you know, you want to talk about a story that's, you know, everybody and their brother has and was telling me no, starting this thing from nothing.
Well, that was actually the next thing, because you talk about legacies and you talk about a higher purpose. I mean, your story for starting Folds of Honor, which ever since I've met you, ever since I've been in the squadron, you know, I've become a big supporter of. I didn't know much about before, you know, joining the 301st, but having seen some of the things you've done and some of the things, you know, when we went to the NASCAR race, did that flyby, you know, it's kind of opened my eyes to a different world. So tell that story. A lot of people maybe not have heard it, which, by the way, the link's in the description, foh.org, if you want to check that out. That's a good thing. We've done some charity work on the channel, but how did Folds of Honor come about?
Yeah, so, and before I dive into that story, so you talked about the NASCAR race. So this is a spoiler alert for everybody tuned in to celebrate your 200,000 subscriber. But we're going to run the Folds of Honor Quick Trip 500 on June 7th.
Oh, cool.
Yeah. So it was canceled with COVID. We were supposed to run it in March.
Yeah.
And, you know, we got to do the flyover to that last year, and that was just an awesome experience. And so right now it looks like it probably will be without fans. NASCAR has announced they're going to start running in May. No fans at least through May.
Okay.
We are June 7th.
So maybe.
Maybe. Or we might have some level. We'll see. But, you know, it's 4 hours on Fox Sports, nationally televised, you know, our NASCAR race. And but in the spirit of that, we have come a long way in 12 years since I started Folds above my garage.
Yeah. And, as any great business does, right? They all start in your garage and then they end up.
Yeah, you start with one subscriber, and here you are with 200,000.
Yeah.
And you're not in your garage, but you're in your home office. So.
No, yeah.
Yeah, so above my garage was my home office. Mm-hmm. And again, I, you know, call them moments of synchronicity, but these just these divine interventions in our life. And if you're watching and you're inspired to take action, that's when, you know, synchronicity can be life-changing. So often we're inspired and we do nothing with it, right? But thank God in this case I did. And I just gotten back from my second tour of duty in Iraq, flying the mighty Viper.
Yeah,
and
best jet ever.
I am best jet ever. It is. And I was going to my other job as a golf pro.
Oh, wow.
And I had to commute. So I was living in Tulsa and I was working in Michigan. And so I'm commuting through Chicago here, Tulsa, Chicago here, Chicago, Grand Rapids. It's a crappy night. I've gone from beer to coffee. finally get on the flight. And as I'm walking through first class, there's a corporal in dress army greens And I didn't think much of it. And I press on back to coach, and about midnight, we finally land in Grand Rapids. And as we're pulling up to the gate, the captain comes over the PA and announces that we're carrying the remains of Corporal Brock Buckland, who'd been killed in Iraq, and his identical twin brother, Corporal Brad Buckland, is in first class and has, you know, brought it back. Captain makes another request that everybody stay in their seats until Brock's remains have been removed from the right cargo hold.
Yep.
And, you know, that's one of the things, too. I mean, you're going to go to combat. You've been there. You see stuff that's terrible. Yep. But it's in theater. And I sat on the right-hand side of the airplane that night, and I watched the family on the darkest, you know, moment of their lives. And his, you know, his brothers are out there, his parents, his wife, his four-year-old son, and Brock's American flag-draped coffin is inching from the cargo hold.
Yep.
And that moment really hit me in a very different way than combat ever had in the finality of the sacrifice.
It's real. It's a real, that's the real reality of it. Yeah, that's
yeah. And, you know, the triangle you got on your shirt and the triangle I got on mine, freedom ain't free, right? And so ceremony finishes itself up, and I pick up my backpack and I stand up, and over more than half the people are gone.
Oh, wow.
Right? So they've completely ignored the captain's request to stay in their seats, because now it's 12:45 the next morning and they got to go brush their teeth and climb under that blanket of freedom that 0.5% of this country provided the other 99.5%. And I will say that was the most angry, disappointed moment I've ever been as an American. I was just disgusted. And I'm walking off the airplane, and the only thing I know for certain in my life is, you know, there was a hand on my shoulder that night, and it was the hand of God. And he picks the least among us, but he picks the willing and the able. And, you know, I knew with every fiber of my being that this is what I was supposed to do. And so, you know, God drops this in my lap. And I mean, up until that point, I will tell you, I mean, I was a pretty average guy. Yeah. I mean, I was, you know, golf pro, fighter pilot, but, you know, but I was, you know, just as like, you know, the walk of life. I wasn't a bad person, but, you know, I stayed at the squadron bar too late. You know, I was cross country. I was playing golf. You know, I was having a lot of me time. Just leave it at that, right? And I got a wife and I have kids. And this whole thing for me, I mean, it's like, you know, Proverbs 27, iron sharpens iron, is one man sharpens another. I mean, this thing has just changed me in so many good ways over the last 12 years. And, but so, you know, where do you start? So I wanted to help this kid's four-year-old son get an education, because I think that was my greatest fear. If anything ever happened to me, who would take care of my wife and my kids? And so we hosted this little golf tournament at the golf course in Michigan. And I'll tell you a fun story. Remind me to tell you the story of American Dunes after this.
Okay.
Because I'm gonna be with Jack Nicklaus on Friday and Saturday up there. But
that's so cool.
So we raised like $8,000, and I looked around at other military foundations to like give the money to, and I couldn't even get anybody to call me back.
Yeah.
I'm like, screw this. And there wasn't anybody that did exactly what I wanted. I wanted to take care of the spouses and the kids and their education.
All right.
And so I'm like, what the heck? I'll start my own. And so I started above my garage, and I ended up giving that $8,000 away, and came up with a concept called Patriot Golf Day. And my idea was, let's have golfers across America tee it up and donate at least an extra dollar when they play.
Oh, cool.
And so I contacted the president of the PGA of America, so largest sports organization.
Wow.
And they called me back, and I said, you know, here I'm, this dude above my garage, and, you know, here's what I'm trying to do.
Wow.
And it's like, it's against all odds, right? And they believed in me. There was, you know, massive struggles along the way getting this thing going. I was the, you know, the janitor and the founder, and all by myself on my computer with nothing. And that summer, the more synchronicity, the PGA Championship happened to be here in Tulsa. And I took David Faraday up on an F-16 ride, and CBS Sports did a big special and covered it. And we kicked this thing off like four weeks before Labor Day, which was when Patriot Golf Day was, because that was the next big golf holiday. Yep. Like, why not Memorial Day? Because, I mean, I was golf. Putting this thing out, making it up as I go, right? All right, Labor Day, next holiday. It's after the PGA Championship. And so we signed up like 3,300 golf courses. So you have to register your golf course to participate. And anybody out there that's plays golf or is affiliated, patriotgolfday.com, and make sure your local golf course is signed up. You can find a golf course that participates coming up over Labor Day weekend again this year. But that first year we signed up over 3,000 courses and we raised $1.1 million.
Wow.
Out of the gate. And I'm still above my garage, dude. It's just me. And the mail guy starts coming to my house with like bags of mail because people are sending in the donation. And he was like, what are you doing? Are you like running a drug house here or what has happened? But that's how this thing, you know, morphed. And, you know, we've raised or given away about $130 million since we started, and to the tune of 25,000 scholarships to spouses and kids who've had somebody killed or disabled in Iraq or Afghanistan. And, you know, from those humble beginnings, we've got a, you know, a NASCAR race that Quick Trip and Coca-Cola sponsor. Yep. And, you know, we work with brands from, you know, Budweiser to Rite Aid, to Delta, to Southwest, to American Airlines, your employer. We're the official military charity for the NBA. Wow. And Major League Baseball. It is just incredible, the folks that
and Fox,
that support us.
Fox and Friends, right? We were on for the NASCAR race. Yeah. They're very big supporters. So
So a contributor to Fox and Friends. Wow. And work with Hannity and Dan Bongino, and was just on with Ed Henry last week, and so do a ton of stuff on Fox. We raise a boatload of money with those guys. I mean, those are our people. Yeah. Right? These are God-fearing people that get it. And it's just been a biblical journey.
Wow.
And we continue, right?
So one of the comments says, just finished your book today. Why don't you tell us about your new book? Didn't you?
He didn't finish that book.
Well,
that
today. Book. So you have a book, and now you've got one coming out, right?
I'm not quite caught up to you, Mover, but and there aren't many. There are not many fighter pilots who are even capable of writing a book. Not true.
In crayon. So most usually pilots, crayon or Sharpie or whatever. It's tough.
Yeah. I would say most fighter pilots I've met could run a small country if they weren't, you know, busy flying fast jets. It's an impressive group of people, unlike any I've ever been around. But, yeah, so my first book was A Patriot's Calling, Living Life Between Fear and Faith. And you can get that on, you know, any of them out there, Amazon, Books A Million, Apple Books. It's available in audio version.
Oh, cool. Did you read it? Well. Are you the narrator?
I read it. The most painful thing I've ever done
reading
in my
book.
Life.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. With two people watching you, two people listening in New York City. And when you talk like a redneck Oklahoma dude, like I do, and they're like, yeah, you got to do that sentence again. You need to do that sentence again. It was a 2-day.
Oh no.
10 hour long, both days process, and then go back in for a re-record.
Oh no.
And I'm getting ready to fire back up. So that one, that was pretty fun. It was like, you know, it's like everything. I wrote that book and nobody would publish it. And so I self-published the thing. And I sold about 40,000 copies of that book.
With
zero marketing, no website. And just strictly word of mouth. People that would buy it and they'd call up and they'd order it. And I would answer the phone. They were like, what? Yeah, I'm sending them to the end of my garage, dude. How many do you want?
That garage, man, it's getting some mileage.
I know. I want 1,000 books out of your garage. But it was just, you know, it's the can-do spirit. And so that one, and but I went through, and I think, you know, you alluded to this before, but I went through this process, which you've distilled into the last 20 minutes here, I went through a really hard period for 10 years, a lot of struggle every day. I built a golf course in 2008 here called the Patriot Golf Club in Tulsa. So, went through all of that. I woke up for 6 years of my life going bankrupt every day.
Yeah. 2008 is a rough time for, it's like it now, essentially what's happening now.
Yeah. But we're going to come back from this.
Yes.
We're going to come back from this one. It's hard now too, but, that and, just, some other struggles. Again, details aren't important, but I've journaled these struggles and it basically distilled down over a 10-year introspection of, getting my balls kicked in, was what you can control in an uncontrollable world. When your world around you is an unsolvable problem, you have to build this kind of hyper-focused insular code of living for me.
Yep.
And I called it CAVU.
Oh.
So that was my code of living. And we know this is a fighter pilot term. If you guys don't know what it means, it's an acronym, stands for Ceiling Invisibility Unlimited or Unrestricted, either one.
Yep.
But it's the perfect day to go fly. It's my favorite color. People ask me my favorite color, CAVU. It's that light blue, perfect sky. So this book coming out, the title is Fly Into the Wind, How to Harness Faith and Fearlessness on Your Ascent to Greatness.
Wow.
And this book is all about the struggle. And I came up with, in my own little world, my own little code of living, there were 12 lines of effort or tenets that I execute every day. And I put those together in with stories of my own life, but I was able to weave in just epically better examples than me of people that emulate these characteristics.
Yeah.
And, whether it's President Bush 41, whether
you've met, correct? You've met.
Yeah. I know the Bushes very well, very well. And President Bush 43 is going to help me launch. The book comes out.
Wow.
This one comes out, November 17th. So I'm launching in the holiday season. So with all the big boys, it is, it's going to change a lot of lives.
Good.
It really is. And it's all about finding, it's all about getting better and not letting the challenges of life derail your, incremental process on a daily basis. And, the number one regret on people's deathbed, Mover, is they wish they lived a life true to themselves, not the life that others expected of them.
Absolutely.
That's the number one regret on people's deathbed. And this book is a, paint by numbers.
Awesome.
To go and write your own job description of life.
Wow.
And have the reckless faith to do that. It's a very faith forward book. That's a big part of my life.
Someone asked, can you pre-order it now? Is it available for
pre-order? Yeah. So you can go to my website, which is danrooney.com. That's an easy one, danrooney.com, and the book's up there, and you can pre-order on all the the usual suspects, Amazon and Books a Million, and and the publisher's HarperCollins.
So you got a publisher now. So you have your
publishing it to the oldest, largest publisher. House in the world.
Nice.
And HarperCollins is publishing, and they've been amazing. And I learned so much about writing, and that process was brutal.
Editing's the worst
and all consuming. They really pushed me, but it was one of the coolest comments that I've gotten. This was a few weeks ago. I've got a couple galley copies just the other day, and my editor called me and he was like, brother, he's like, we've circulated this, your manuscript around HarperCollins, and to a person, I said, nobody's ever read anything like it.
Nice.
And it is, it's perfectly broken. And I'll tell one, because we got fighter pilots.
Yeah, we got to have some, we got to have some fighter pilot stories on this.
Yeah, so this is a cool analogy. And my last chapter is called Broken Wings. And when you get your set of wings, when you go off to pilot training, the very first set, these beautiful polished wings, it's like the greatest day of your life. And honestly, for me, I mean, my wife was here, she wouldn't care. We've been married for 21 years. It was better than my wedding.
Yeah.
It was, you know, I mean, yeah, it's a big day. I mean, it's just such a massive day.
Yeah.
But you take your first set of wings and you promptly break them in half. Snap them in half, never to be put together again. You know, out of respect and humility for the business that we're in, and you give the other half to, you know, your closest confidant, and that is still to me. I gave my other half to a guy by the name of Spike Kelly, who was my instructor pilot there. He was a Viper guy punched out in Iraq, so he's a famous dude.
Yeah,
he was my IP and still one of my dearest friends. Jeez. And in life. But you know, again, it's the premise of, you know, our brokenness is our most perfect form.
Yep.
And we live in this world where everybody's trying to hide their mistakes.
Yep.
Right. Everybody's so afraid of messing up. And at 47, when I meet somebody now, I'm like, I do not care one bit what you've accomplished. Tell me what you've overcome.
Absolutely.
And our wounds are where the brightest light of God shines through. And
yep.
Own it.
Yep. Yep.
And it's just really cool. So enough about that. But
no, that's awesome.
Fly into the wind, and I'll send you a copy of the cover. Unbelievably cool.
Yeah. Awesome. So you flew the F-16 and the T-38. The T-38's a lot of fun, but what was your favorite part about flying the Viper?
Well, number one, the T-38 is a lot harder to fly than the Viper.
Yep.
I mean, it's the hardest airplane I've ever flown in my life.
Especially in the weather. Especially these jets in the weather.
Oh, my gosh. the plane literally tries to kill you every 3 seconds if you don't pay attention to it.
Yep.
And it does. It's still, I mean, the fatality rate in that thing is, there's such great respect, but... before I jump into the Viper, the great thing about the T-38, though, it's stick and rudder, man. It's a pure sports car. It demands you to be a pilot. It talks to you.
That used to be how they would determine. I mean, that was the A model has gotten so many tears from people washing out because they couldn't fly it to fly anything, because it was T-37 or T-33, T-38, and then whatever you're going to fly. So it's broken a lot of people. Over what, 60, 70 years? It's a pretty old airplane.
Oh, yeah, since 1961, I think, is when they started flying it. But yeah, it is. But I think you'll agree, because when you go through pilot training, I mean, it's fun, but you're terrified the entire time, right? Yeah. Because you know you're three rides from going home, right? A couple busts and an 89, and you're gone, and so you never really settle in to enjoy it like you should. But to go back to the T-38,
it's fun now.
You had a lot of fun.
Yeah.
Like it's an old lover, right?
So you went through college, and how old were you when you went through pilot training? Like how?
I was 26.
Okay.
26. So it took me a little while to get hired.
Yeah.
I wanted to go the Air Guard route. And if I didn't get in, I was going to pull the ticket and go regular Air Force.
Okay.
But yeah. I was 26 when I went in, and I took a little break. So that my life storm was so crappy, I walked away from my boyhood dream of flying fighters, and I didn't ever think I was going to go back. Because I mean, I literally was going to lose my house. Folds of Honor was, you know, on, you know, emergency oxygen, and we were just trying to get started. That wasn't going to work. I mean, everything was falling apart, and I walked away from a very promising career. I was pegged. I was going to weapons school.
Oh, wow.
I was, you know.
Yeah.
I was wired for greatness, and I wouldn't change it. I mean, based on what we've been able to do at Folds and where my life is now, but it was a really painful period. But going back to the, you know, the Viper, and I've heard you talk about this stuff, on the show, but I think that, you know, the coolest thing about that airplane is your thoughts become motion.
You wear the jet.
Yeah, it transcends you. I mean, you don't even, you just don't think about it. It's like you look there, you go there. The visibility is unparalleled. We had the Pratt & Whitney, the 229, so we had the big motor.
Nice.
And they would give you 9Gs all day long. I don't miss that at all. I mean, that is hard living, man. 9Gs is hard living in that airplane. But no, it was just it was great. Obviously, you know, I've flown a bunch of combat with 3 trips over to Iraq, and getting to do that was, you know, was fantastic. And those were, you know, when you were truly on your game, that was the best you ever were flying the airplane. I always remember that very fondly.
You miss it. You miss it though. After, you know, you miss being at the pointy end of the spear, right? I mean, at this point, even though you're doing greater things now, you look back and
Yeah. I think, you know, that's God's calling for all of us, is, you know, to be your best.
Yeah.
And I truly miss how myopic that and simple that place was in your career, when you're, you know, a 4-ship flight leader, a mission commander, and you're great at what you do, and you have time to sit in the vault and go in on the weekend and jump in the sim, and you're just eat, drink, sleep.
Yep.
Being a Viper pilot.
Yep.
And hanging on to the tail is no fun. And catching up and not being as good as you can. And, you know, that's the story of my life right now as a, you know, a part-time fighter pilot. But
it's tough. And you're still flying civilian, right? You've got the Noonan 1 that you fly back and forth.
Yep. I got Noonan 1, and that thing's getting ready. Noonan 1's getting ready to get quite a bit of airtime. Details forthcoming, but I'm going to do a show on Fox Nation.
Oh, cool.
Called Fly Into the Wind.
Nice.
And I'm going to go sit down. I'm taking Noonan 1, so it'll be part of the show. So it's all wired for sound and cameras and that whole thing. And I'm going to go sit down with famous people, and there'll be 25-minute segments for Fox Nation and talk to them about their darkest, most challenging moments in life, and
that's amazing.
How they got on the other side of them and ultimately are better off. And it's the common denominator in life, Mover. Everybody struggles.
Yeah.
Right. But it's, as I said before, it's so isolating and ironic, because that's the one thing that bonds all humanity together.
Yeah. Struggle.
We struggle, but we hide it. We isolate it. I mean, you know, we've got 22 veterans a day committing suicide right now. And I just really hope, you know, my one unwavering mission is to create, you know, authentic, real life inspiration and advice for people, from people that you would, you know, respect, whether it's Dirk Bentley or Hulk Hogan.
That's
or
awesome.
You know, Drew Brees, you know,
hey, you got you gotta let me know when that one happens. I gotta be there.
Drew's in the book too. Drew's in the new book.
The Noonan 1 is what now, they're asking, just for clarification. It's a Cirrus.
Yeah, it's an SR-22.
Okay.
Aspirated, so it's not the turbo, but it is. It's too bad we don't have a picture. It is. Yeah. It's one of a kind. Cirrus did the design. It's one of a kind. It is air superiority gray.
Nice.
And the tail number is 130 Romeo Golf, and so 13 is my God number. There were 12 apostles, Jesus number 13. Obviously 13 folds that bring the flag to that iconic shape of freedom on your shirt, Mover.
Amazing.
And then Romeo Golf stands for Rooney Golf or Rooney Girls.
Oh.
In my case. But it is a wickedly cool little time machine.
Well, I know you're very busy, but if you have time, we've got a couple quick questions for you, and then I'll let you get back the best.
There's nobody yelling at me in the background.
So one of the questions we're getting from the chat is, why did you go to the Air Guard? Like, what was the, you talked about Portland and Tulsa. Did you think about active duty? Did you think about the Navy? Like, why Why stay local? I didn't know.
The reason I went to the Air Guard is because the guy I met that I mentioned before, Steve Courtright, Reno, was a guardsman. Oh. And so I was fortunate to find out, which I still think it's the greatest kept secret in the world, because you have much more control over your destiny. Yep. And so you're not guaranteed. It's still and Shots ran these statistics. Shots is a guy that flies with Mover and I.
Yeah.
But right now, if you start pilot training, the 4.8% of the people that start pilot training will successfully complete a fighter B course.
Okay.
That's crazy, right? So 95% are going to end up flying something else or not making it through. And so I like two things about the Air Guard. Number one, I had to get hired. So that was the hard part. But fortunately, I had a couple of job offers. So you got to go interview for those positions. And but once you get hired, you know what you're going to go fly, assuming you can make it back to it and successfully complete the training. And as an Oklahoma guy, to come back and fly F-16s, I knew all the bros that were flying in the squadron. It was home for me. And I could have an entire career, should I choose, flying fighter jets. And the problem with the active duty Air Force, it's the dumbest thing I've ever seen in my life, and it still is. How you get all these guys good at flying fighter jets, and then you go send them to fly a desk at the Pentagon. You send them to, you know, a white jet tour, teaching kids how to fly. And I just, you know, if the opportunity is there, man, go guard. Yeah. And it is awesome.
Yeah, it's a very competitive and very good. So one of the questions for you next that everyone asks me all the time, how many UFOs have you seen?
None.
It's the same thing. I always say that. People think we go out and we see UFOs all the time. Zero. I've seen zero. I did
see the Navy release that the other day, the feed on CBS News or whatever.
Yeah.
Man, I've never seen him, and I've flown around the outskirts of Area 51 at Red Flag all the time. I've never seen him out there at night.
Yeah, that's
in the land of Martians.
Yeah. So, let's see if we got. That's a flat Earth joke. I'm not going to do any flat Earth jokes on here. I did a video about the flat Earth, and there's actually literally people that still believe the Earth is flat. So one of the questions now is, how many years of service have you done? Obviously, you're still in.
I've got 18 years. So I took I had a break in service for 4 years, Mover, and so I've got 18 years. And so right now I've got two more left, and then we'll see where God leads me.
Is that the plan to go to 20 and then see what happens?
I'm going to make it to 20 and assess. And as you know, our future is very uncertain at Eglin. But there, you know, there are other cool opportunities out there. So we'll see where God leads us. But I'm going to hit the 20 mark. How many are you, Mover?
I'm at 14.
All right.
14 years. So I've got a while, especially if I make 05. So one of the
you have your PME done?
No, I'm holding out. I need to.
That's fun. I'll tell you, that's another. If you want to get into that, stupidest things ever.
Here's a question: how could you ever be sure the military is right for you? T-Bear was on here, which was great. The service before self. How do you know that's right for you? Should you walk in just, hey, I just want to fly fighter jets, or is there something bigger to it?
I would have never gone in if fully honest answer.
Yeah.
I wanted to be a fighter pilot.
Yeah.
And that was my driver. I think that you need to look at the military and make sure there's a job that you love within the military before you ever raise your right hand.
Yeah.
Because I love the military. I love the people in it. I've been in 18 years. I'm not going to sugarcoat it. It will let you down as well.
Yeah.
And you just can't go in expecting the military to care and feed and nurture you. That's not its job. Our job is to break people's stuff. And they can not be really good at taking care of the people within the military sometimes. But that ultimately, I mean, that's the acid test, right? That is service before self. We're willing to put up with shortcomings, but I don't think it's unlike any, you know, business or occupation that's out there. I mean, it's a big organization. There's going to be faults there. And I don't think you can ever be certain of anything in life.
There are no guarantees for sure.
There's nothing. There's no 100% anywhere. If that individual, I know if I hadn't done it, one of the big markers for me is everybody's like, oh, should I do this? Should I not do this? Everybody's had that moment.
Yeah.
Is you fast forward and look back at your life when you're 80 years old, would you regret not doing this? And that was a total yes. And you can go in, and if you know you don't like it, you can do it for 4 years and you get out.
Yeah.
But I promise you'll be better off having served in the military.
So someone reminded me, I'm supposed to remind you about the dunes. That was way back. We never got back to it.
Yeah. Awesome. What a great place to start. So another fly into the wind moment. Mm-hmm. So my family's golf course up in Michigan, 20 years we've had it, failed to make money almost every one of those 20 years, labor of law, but we enjoy the place. It's Grand Haven, Michigan. That's where I was traveling to on the flight that started Folds of Honor. That's where we had the first golf tournament, was at Folds of Honor. So it's a very emotional place to us, very meaningful. But my dad's 80, and we're like, we have to have a plan, because I'm busy and you don't want to run it. I don't want to run it as is. And so I had this idea to memorialize the birthplace of Folds of Honor.
Oh, cool. Yeah.
But in order to do that, we had to completely, rebrand the place from the old Grand Haven Golf Club is what it is. And it's a really nice place, but it's just another golf course. But I needed a mission commander to do that. And so I went down and met with my friend Jack Nicklaus, who's won more major championships than anybody in the history of the game of golf, 18 professionals and two amateurs, so 20 major championships. And I told him about my situation, and he said, Dan, my fee to design a golf course is $3 million, right?
Oh God.
Like, yes sir, I'm aware of that. He said, but you know what? He was like, I love the game of golf, and it's provided an amazing livelihood for me, but I love my country even more.
Yeah.
Let's do this. So he said, I'll waive my fee. So I got $3 million a downstroke into this thing. Let's go find our friends and reimagine the Grand Haven Golf Club. So this has been an 18-month journey we're on. And we have literally scraped the project. It sits about 100 yards from Lake Michigan in pure sand.
Wow.
And we took every piece of turf, every piece of grass off of it. We deforested 100 acres of trees and created this just majestic dunescape. Mm-hmm. And the name of the golf course is American Dunes. And it'll open this fall. Is the official birthplace of Folds of Honor, and a place of public golf course that is all about healing and hope for our veterans and people to come support the Folds of Honor mission. And you'll love this, Mover. So we've gutted the clubhouse, and so you have obviously the golf shop and stuff, but the old restaurant is being turned into a massive squadron bar.
Oh, nice.
There's this huge squadron bar with the squadron rules up on the wall. You can buy your mug for the year for $5,000, which will fund one scholarship if you want to. Wow. And Budweiser will fill it up for the entire year. We've got old ejection chairs.
Oh, that's cool.
To sit in. It is just, it's wonderful. And there'll be a memorial that tells the story of Folds of Honor. And you're actually, when you come into the property, Mover, we've we've casted boot prints of soldiers who've been killed in action, whose families are Folds of Honor recipients. Mm-hmm. And so as you walk through the pavers, their boot prints will be in the cement. And there's a big wall that tells their story and their family's story before you even get into the place.
Yeah.
And then the one of the cool traditions is every day at 1300, which is obviously 1 o'clock, we'll have our honorary military foursome on the first tee, and we will play taps over a big bell tower, and then the bell will toll 13 times, signifying each one of the folds of the flag that bring into that triangle shape, and the whole place will shut down every day for 2.5 minutes while we welcome our honored veterans there. But this place is, you want to talk about the volume up, man, on who we are and what we stand for. It is going to be like a spaceship of God and country.
That is awesome.
Landing in West Michigan. And I'm almost done. I'll finish up here. So my first trip since the quarantine, we're, you know, blessed to have a great supporter that's coming to, I'm actually flying Newton one to Memphis where his airplane is.
Oh.
And then we're jumping in his G500 and going to pick up Jack and Barbara and in West Palm, and then we'll fly up to this town is Grand Haven, Michigan, because Jack is finishing his sign-off work as the architect on the final 6 holes up there.
Wow.
And so we're going to do that on Friday for a day trip.
Nice. And, a day trip. Yeah. That's just, all right. Yeah, that's a...
Just a day trip, man. When you're flying that fast.
Yeah. I mean,
yeah, geez. We do a day trip to Europe in that machine.
Better than a T-38, right? I mean, it's a little bit more comfortable, or...
Yeah, but, I'd rather do it in a T-38, but we can't fit all those people in there. That's the problem.
No.
But no, I mean, I think it, you know, the moral of that story is build your life squadron.
Yeah.
You know, put great people around you and you can move mountains.
Yeah.
And I have been so blessed to, you know, to build a great life squadron that would have never existed without all the struggles in my life. Because I'd never go ask Jack Nicklaus to do this with me if the old Grand Haven Golf Club ain't, you know, has one engine on fire.
God.
And, you know, losing 2,000 feet per minute. I never go make that call. It's out of pure desperation. And we see that story written over and over again by these, you know, rare individuals that, you know, when you face struggle, just be honest and ask for help, man. They're everybody's been there. They're people that want to help you out. And how you react, as you know, as a fighter pilot, you know, what do you do in an emergency and how you react?
Maintain aircraft control, analyze the situation, take proper action, land as soon as conditions permit.
Amen. Amen.
It works for everything. It works for life.
It works for life. It is, that's in my book.
Is it really?
Awesome. Right. Yeah. Aviate, navigate, communicate.
Absolutely.
Right? So, yeah. Who are you? Where do you want to go? And if you got time, talk about it.
Yeah.
But people spend way too much time talking and not near enough time doing in this world.
So for those that want to support Folds, what is the best way in general? Obviously through the website is probably.
Go ahead. We have an awesome program.
Are there chapters
There are. Then the chapters are on the website. So we have chapters around the country. But the easy button to hit right now, we really need it. I mean, the COVID's been a crusher on all charities across this country, and it really has. We have a wingman program, which is $13 a month. And we know what that number means because people have been listening to me talk too much already. But you can go online, foldsofhonor.org, become a wingman, and that would be fantastic. And check out danrooney.com if you want to pick up an early copy of Fly Into the Wind or Patriots Calling. They're both really fun. And maybe one of these days we get back in the jet together. Mover.
Oh, yeah. Well, you know, virtually, since we're doing esports, last year we did the Folds of Honor, Fight for Honor DCS tournament.
Oh.
Can we get Noonan in an F-16 in DCS?
I am in. I just gotta figure out how to set it up. But brother, I am in, and I'd be honored to roll into that fight.
We will have to do another tournament this year. I think this year we gotta go bigger. Somehow we gotta figure it out.
Oh, you're the best, man. You are the best. And you know, God bless everybody during these challenging times, and congratulations on going before you're ready, man. 200,000 subscribers, and thanks for representing all fighter pilots so well.
It's been an honor. Well, sir, I appreciate you being on the channel. I appreciate you calling in. Thank you for your time. I know you're busy. You're doing great work out there, and I'm looking forward to flying again. We got to fly together at some point this year.
It'll be fun, man. All right. God bless to everybody out there. Mover, I salute you, brother.
Yes, sir. Appreciate it.
All right.
Take care. Excuse me. Oh, no. Oh!
Met a lot of them.
God. Actually, fly with the doors off. All hot speed.
Don't be a douche.
Rule number one. Make them tell you no.